Part 2, Chapter 22 of A Vital Question, or What is to be Done, by Nikolay Chernyshevsky. Translated by Nathan Haskell Dole, 1852-1935, and others. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by expatriate in Bangor, Maine. Part 2, First Love and Legal Marriage, Chapter 22. But we have had only one half of this scene. For about a moment, no, rather less, Marya Alexeyevna, who had suspected nothing of the kind, stood thunderstruck, endeavoring to understand, and absolutely failing to understand what her daughter had said, what it meant, and how it came about. But it was only for a moment, or even less. She came to herself with a start. She uttered some objurgation or other, but her daughter was already far down the Nevsky. Marya Alexeyevna dashed several steps in her direction. "Must take an izvoshchik," she turned to the sidewalk. "Izvoshchik! Where do you want to go, lady?" Where did she want to go? She heard her daughter say, "To Karavanaya Street," but her daughter turned to the left down the Nevsky. Where does she want to go? "I want to overtake her yonder, that beast." "To catch someone? Speak sense. Where do you want to go? How can I go without any direction? And you hain't give me any idea." Marya Alexeyevna entirely lost control of herself, and she began to berate the izvoshchik. "You are drunk, Baruina, that's all there is of it," said the izvoshchik, and left her. Marya Alexeyevna ran after him, still scolding, and she shouted at the other izvoshchiks, and she dashed in all directions for some time, and she gesticulated with her hands, and then she went back under the colonnade, and she kicked, and she acted like a madwoman. And around her were gathered half a dozen rude fellows, who had been peddling various articles around the columns of the Gostinui Dvor. The fellows were laughing at her, and they exchanged among themselves words of more or less unfavorable character, and they praised her ironically, and they offered her their advice to be calm. "Ay, da, Baryunya, how early you managed to get full! Lively, Baryuna! Baryuna, ah, Baryuna, buy half a dozen lemons of me. They are good to take when you're tipsy. I'll let thee have them cheap. Baryuna, ah, Baryuna, don't listen to him. A lemon won't do you the least good, but go and take a nap. Baryuna, ah, Baryuna, you're a good hand at scolding. Let's get up a scolding match and see who'll beat." Marya Alexeyevna, not knowing at all what she was about, boxed the ears of one of the nearest of her interlocutors, a fellow of 17, who, not without grace, was stretching out his tongue at her. His hat flew off, and his hair was right at hand. Marya Alexeyevna got her fingers into it. This act roused the rest of her interlocutors into a state of indescribable enthusiasm. "Ay, Baryuna, give it to him!" Others shouted, "Fyedka, give it back to her in small change!" But the majority of the interlocutors were on Marya Alexeyevna's side. "How can Fyedka stand up to her? Give it to him, Baryuna! Knock Fyedka down! He deserves it, the rascal!" A good many spectators had now collected besides the interlocutors, both izvoshchiks and the clerks of the shops and the passers-by. Marya Alexeyevna, as though coming to her senses, and with a final mechanical motion pushing away Fyedka's head, started across the street. The enthusiastic praises of her interlocutors accompanied her. She saw that she was on the way home after she had passed the doors of the school of pages. She took an izvoshchik and reached home in safety. Finding Fyodor at the door, she gave him a beating. She rushed to the cupboard. She pounded Matryona, who came out to see what made the noise. Again she rushed to the cupboard. She dashed to Vyerotchka's room. Then she rushed back again to the cupboard. Once more she dashed to Vyerotchka's room and remained there a long time. Then she made a tour of all the rooms, scolding, but finding no one on whom to lay her hands. Fyodor had run to the rear stairs. Matryona, who was looking through the crack of Vyerotchka's room, frightened out of her wits, ran back when she saw that Marya Alexeyevna was getting up. She lost her head and could not find her way to the kitchen, but found herself instead under Marya Alexeyevna's bed, where she remained in safety until she was called out under a flag of truce. Whether it was a long or short period that she was scolding and shouting as she walked through the empty rooms, Marya Alexeyevna could never tell. But it must have been long, because when Pavel Konstantinovitch came from his office, he also had a dose, both materially and ideally, from Marya Alexeyevna. but as everything must come to an end, Marya Aleks^yevna cried out, " Matri6na, let us have dinner !" Matri6na saw that the storm was ended ; she crept out from under the bed and got dinner. At dinner Marya Aleks^yevna did not scold at all, but she only growled without any intentions of attacking, but only for her own satisfaction ; and afterwards she did not take a nap, but sat down alone and did not speak, but was growling. Then she stopped growling and became absolutely silent. Finally she cried out, " Matri6na, wake the barin, and tell him to come to me." Matri6na, who, while expecting orders, did not dare to go into the dining room or anywhere else, fulfilled the command. Pavel Konstantinuitch appeared. " Go to the khozydika and tell her that our daughter has married that devil because you wished her to. Tell her, it was against my wife's will. Tell her that you did so, so as to please her ladyship, because you saw that it was not her ladyship's wish. Tell her, my wife was alone to blame, and I only carried out your ladyship's will. Tell her, I myself brought them together. Do you understand or not?" " I understand you, Marya Aleks^yevna. You are very wise in your plan." " Well, then, go along with you. Even if she is eating her dinner, don't mind. Call her right out. Bring her from the dinner table, so long as she does not know the real truth." The assurance of Pavel Konstantinovitch's words was so impressive that the khozydika would have believed him even if he had not possessed the gift of a persuasive tongue. But the impressiveness of this gift was so great that the khozydika would have forgiven Pavel Konstantinovitch even if there had not been substantial proofs that he had constantly acted against his wife and purposely brought Vierotchka and Lopukh6f together in order to block the ignoble marriage of Mikhail Ivanovitch. But how did they get married? Pavel Konstantinovitch was not stingy in giving her a dowry. He had given Lopukh6f 5,000 rubles in cash, and he had given the marriage and all its costs at his own expense. Through him, the young people had exchanged little notes. They had met at the house of his colleague, the Nachalnik Filantyov, a married man, your ladyship. Although I am a man of little account, the maiden honor of my daughter, your ladyship, is dear to me. They met in my presence, and although we have not money enough to justify giving a boy of the age of ours a tutor, yet I hired one for an excuse, your ladyship, etc., etc. His wife's unreliability Pavel Konstantinovitch depicted in the darkest colors. How then could she help being convinced and forgiving Pavel Konstantinovitch? And the main thing, what a great and unexpected piece of happiness! Joy softens the heart. The khozydika began her speech of forgiveness with a very long explanation of the thoughts and actions of Marya Aleks^yevna, and at first asked Pavel Konstantinovitch to send his wife away, but he implored her, and she herself acknowledged that it was rather for show than because she meant it. Finally, it was decided that Pavel Konstantinovitch should retain his place as manager, that they should give up their rooms facing the street and take another suite in the back of the building, on condition that his wife should not dare to show her face in those places on the first dvor where the khozydika's eyes might fall, and that she should be obliged to go out of doors when she went at all by a staircase that lay far from the khozydika's windows. From the 20 rubles a month that had been added to his salary, 15 rubles should be taken back, and 5 rubles would be left to him for a compensation for the manager's energy in the khozydika's interests and towards the expenses of his daughter's wedding. End of part 2, chapter 22. Recording by expatriate in Bangor, Maine.